the type of pressure that comes with being Jordan Horstin, a lot of expectations, and then also you couple that with the heightened of social media, and then just the pressure to win coming from a program such as Afrocentric that's been a story program that's have won the amount of championships that we have won. Jordan Horstin kind of is under a lot of pressure.
My name is Jordan Horstin. I'm a senior at Afrocentric.
It's back to the grind for Jordan and the Lady Nubians. What does it take to be a world-class student athlete? Ability is one thing, but often left unexplored is what they do and how they think off the court.
I go somewhere because I know whatever God blessed me with can be taken away anytime.
Jordan Horstin is a two-time USA gold medalist MVP, and ESPN currently ranks her as the number two high school girls basketball prospect in the world.
Hey, my name is Simon Brutti, and I'm doing a photo shoot for Sports Illustrated on Jordan.
Beyond natural talent and ability, her success has been a product of her psyche, strength of will, and faith in God.
Hello from Horstin.
Horston's really sparkly. She's long, she's athletic, she's talented. I swear I had this whirl in my head when I was young. I swear I had this whirl in my head when I was young. I wanna be a Dwayne Wade. I wanna be a LeBron James.
Hey, who dream like Steph?
This documentary takes a close look at the pressure a student athlete like Jordan faces and shows that these challenges can be overcome in ways that builds character and mental strength.
Are you ready? Access granted.
Someday at Christmas, men won't be boys. Playing with moms like kids play with toys. One warm December, our hearts will see a world where men are free. Someday at Christmas, there'll be no wars. When we have learned what Christmas is for, when we have found what life's really worth, there'll be...
Oh, I'm sorry, now I put something about the last. All right, now I'm last.
There's a that was like 2013.
It might have been.
Yes, she can.
Here, hold on. Here it goes.
I was in it.
What? We're doing it. Wait, here's the old one.
You know, I can't do nothing without my family. You know, my family is everything to me. They're the reason why I continue to go hard. Always there. They're so understanding. Like, they just, like, I swear, they're the best parents ever.
The love that Jordan has for her family is unconditional, and she credits all of her success to them. Jordan comes from a very spiritual family that has instilled Christian values in her that would enhance her athletic abilities and supersede any accomplishment that she has ever been awarded.
My grandmother, which Martha Evans, was like the monarch of savior. We always felt like we were gonna make it to heaven because she was our praying grandmother. And so I'll never forget, she told us, my family, that her time was almost up. and that she was only going to be, she was going to be gone by that following Thanksgiving. And of course, you know, we're looking at her like, you know, how do you know, or, you know, not really, you know, understanding what she's saying. But she had been sick for a while. She had been on dialysis a long time, and, you know. So she did make it to my wedding. Lee and I got married in 1996. My grandmother died in 97, that January. Before she died, you know, I sat in the hospital with her. You know, I talked to her when people wasn't around, and, you know, my family kind of was at odds about the care that she was getting, and everybody kind of wanted to do all these things to try to save her. And then I reminded everybody that she'd already told us that her time was up and that it was time for her to go. And so I just sat there with her, and she was very spiritual. And like that's where I feel like a lot of my faith was instilled in me, was from her. But after she passed away, I'll never forget when I got home. I got home probably, because she was in Steubenville. When I left Steubenville and came back to Ohio, which is like 2-hour drive, as soon as I got back home, they had told me that she had passed away. And that night, which I didn't share with anyone, I sat on the couch, you know, and I cried, and I laid there, and then I had a dream. At least I thought it was a dream. I feel like it was more of a vision. And God came to me, and he told me that if I made a sacrifice, that he had something for me. I didn't know what it was. I didn't know, you know, it was going to be children or, you know, what it was. And I didn't even really know what the sacrifice was going to be. And then I had another dream, and he was like, if you move to Texas, you know, that's the sacrifice. I have no idea where Texas came from.
Jordan's purpose has been allocated and ordained by God to her before she was ever conceived as a child. You see, doctors told the newlywed couple that due to hormone complications, that they would never be able to have children naturally. But what doctors didn't know is that young Malika Horston looked at life through a supernatural lens that had been spiritually cultivated by the teachings of her grandmother, and everything that she had been taught would all make sense at this very moment.
Now, the backstory to all of this is before I had kids, I was told that I wasn't going to be able to have kids on my own. I had some hormone things going on, and they told me that if I wanted to have kids, that I was going to need like fertility or have some type of help. And, you know, so I just always thought, you know, whatever. Me and my husband, we had been together for a long time, and I had never got pregnant. I was 18 when we got together, got married at 23, never got pregnant. But when I moved to Texas, I had to leave my husband because he was still in school. He had 4 months. So when I went, we would see each other once a month. He'd come down or I'd fly back. While I was there, I was staying with my aunt Renee, and she went to church a lot. And so I went with her. And I actually will never forget the service I went to. I went to the service, and I went up for prayer. The lady asked me if I was saved. I said yes. She asked me if I had been baptized. I said yes. She said, have you ever received the Holy Ghost? And I said no. I didn't, you know, I said, I see everyone, you know, speaking in tongues and all those type of things, but, you know, I never experienced it, and I never really knew if it was real. I mean, I knew what the Bible said. But she then told me to lift my hands. And she said, if you want it, she told me, she explained it to me, that God, you having the Holy Ghost, like when you're speaking in tongues, it's God speaking to your heart. Sometimes you don't know what to say or have the words. So sometimes your spirit is going to release those things, and they're communicating. So I remember lifting my hands, and didn't remember what happened after that. And it was the first time, I mean, I've been in church, I've been baptized, I did all these things forever. And from just being around my aunt, going down there, I don't know if it was that setting, that church, whatever it was, that day I received the Holy Ghost. So I remember lifting my hands and didn't remember what happened after that. That was, I made the sacrifice. I received the Holy Ghost, and I feel like that's what he wanted me to have. And then he blessed me.
By being obedient to God's word, God kept his promise to the Horstons, and baby Jordan was brought into this world.
And so when Jordan was born, she was very quiet. She was very advanced, but you wouldn't know it because she wouldn't speak to you.
The type of student Jordan was, well, first, she was the baby, the smartest baby ever, very wise. As a little baby, she was the type of baby that took everything in, very caring and nurturing, even like at 10, 11 months, just she was really special. She was the type of child that would cry silently. Like, you would look over and Jordan would just be crying. And you're like, what's wrong with the baby?
Like, Sabrina would talk to her all the time. She wouldn't talk back. But if she say, you know, Jordan, go get the baby's diaper, talking about her daughter, like, go get the baby's diaper, I mean, immediately, she just get up and go, you know, or Jordan, go do this, like, she would go, because she had a connection with her. But other people that she didn't feel connected with, she just would not speak to them. And I used to worry about her. I used to think, something wrong with my kid. She don't want to talk, because people would be like, can she talk? I said, she talks very well. As a matter of fact, she was reading books at 2, and she was talking to me at like, she had to be about 6 months.
Baby Jordan had traits that made her rare. She was clearly gifted and would be successful in anything she put her hands on.
Parents, first of all, they're wonderful parents. They've always pushed her. Even when I would be like, she can't come over and spend the night, like, just like one night. No, because she has this, and this to do. They kept her on a very good schedule that Jordan wanted to be on. They never did anything that Jordan didn't want to do. You know, they pushed her when it's like, oh, you're gonna finish this. If you started it, you're gonna finish it. They very rarely had to, but you know, they kept her grounded, and she just comes from love, a lot of love. Her sister is her other mother. Her grandmother, my Aunt Isabel, is amazing. They're just, like I said, they're very deep rooted in Christ. I remember Jordan's father training her at like 3. Like, he's always been her coach and always been an amazing coach. And he was serious about basketball, even, I mean, he wasn't strict or anything, but he was just serious about the game. And he gave her very good instructions about the game.
Yeah, he was very precise on what he wanted her to accomplish in practices and timeouts. He would describe what he wanted her to do, and she followed directions very well.
She does. She remembers everything.
She remembers literally everything.
Yeah, she does.
So
Lee is pretty, like, he's like the calm father. Malik is more the, what are you doing? You know you need to do that better or whatever. I mean, just get on her, make her a better player. She always made her a better player. And Lee is just kind of calm, like, I know you can do it, do it. This is what I'm asking you to do, do it. And Malik is like, you need to do that, so.
But it wasn't until her father, Lee Horston, the man who devoted his life to basketball playing and coaching, put a basketball in Jordan's hands. She knew exactly what to do. And the legend begins.
How long? I've been around the game of basketball. Just coming up playing basketball, you know, playing all sports. And then, you know, I was lucky enough to try to play college. I played 1 year, you know, and that's what kind of brought me to Columbus. And kind of fell in love with basketball game. I moved to Texas, lived down there, and a friend of mine wanted me to coach her son in basketball. And so she started an AAU team, and I was kind of got me into coaching basketball. Well, first time coaching basketball.
And I just kind of got the bug and just fell in love with it. So when we came back to Columbus, that was just something that's kind of natural. I found a place to coach, started out coaching at Howard Rec Center. Coached here for a couple years, and then I was lucky enough to get onto a high school staff. And I started coaching high school when Jordan was maybe 2 or 3 years old.
Jordan, though, she's been around since I, you know, was around Coach Horston. Coach Horston was one of my coaches in high school. I remember seeing her run around and doing her thing with the basketball. I knew she had something in her. So just to see what she's doing now, it's no surprise to me. I'm a very big fan of her, very big supporter of her. I haven't actually had a chance to talk to her since she's been dominating, you know, since she became a McDonald's All-America. You know, she should know that the whole city of Columbus is proud of her. She should know that everybody is supporting her. And, the sky's the limit for her. My advice to her is a lot's going to be coming at you just because of, you know, how good you are, but stay focused, stay humble, always keep God first, and,
when I first started recognizing Jordan was a little bit gifted in basketball, I mean, at a young age, you know, we always practiced dribbling that basketball. And as a real young, she was able to dribble. I mean, both hands. Started off with the small balls, and she never had no problems with those. Moving up to the bigger balls, she always can just handle that ball. And so a lot of kids, you know, smack at the ball, whatever, you really got to teach them how to do it. She was just picking stuff up real quick.
Yeah, I just kind of want a shape of you, you know. Yeah, see,
like Jordan,
a little bit like Jordan. Yeah, a little bit like Jordan. Yeah. So the secret to it is hi, my name is Simon Brutti, and I'm doing a photo shoot for Sports Illustrated on Jordan, and we're here at this incredibly sexy location in the car park of the high school. So it's working for us, and that's what the most important thing is, being a photographer.
Hey, girl. What size is that jersey?
Whoa.
Oh. I got you.
Did you give me turkey?
I got all that.
Hey, guys, I'm a
coach. All right. Jordan, this is Sam.
Hi. Nice to meet you.
So, Jordan, this is what we want you to do. We want you. Hey, I'm going to show you quickly. Don't be offended by Sam here. we kind of want you jumping in the air. Alright?
Okay.
So, we're going to get this dramatic sky. Okay? We're going to want you to jump up there. So, let's just start simple. It's not really that bouncy. Okay? You are way more athletic than me.
Oh yeah.
It's pretty solid. Okay. It's very solid. Okay, because I put my weight on it. Right? You know what I mean? And I didn't break it, okay? So I'm gonna be shooting down here. Okay. What do you think? Do you think a layup? I mean, are you dominant? What's your hand?
Right
hand. Right hand. Okay. What about left hand? Do you reckon we do a left hand anymore? Yeah, I just kind of want a shape of you, you know. Yeah, see,
like Jordan,
a little bit like Jordan. Yeah, a little bit like Jordan. Yeah. So the secret to it.
You ever thought in a million years your daughter would be on the cover of Sport Illustrated? How do I feel sitting here watching it right there?
Well, I don't know if she's going to be on the cover.
Or just in it, right?
But never. I'm speechless because I don't really know what to say. I just never. God has in store for her. He just keeps blessing her, and I'm just watching. So I'm just humbly grateful and excited for her. I just pray that she just keeps level-headed and remember, you know, where her blessings flow.
First of all, that's rude.
Oh my god.
Marley! Exactly. See how that works?
I just wanted to say, first of all, I just wanted to say this is a.
Guys, turn off your voice, please. Little kid, stop talking. Hold the basketball.
Well, you know, I just wanted to say that this is a fantastic moment for me every year doing my birthday. I really appreciate you guys coming out and starting my birthday out with me. And it's a very euphoric feeling. And one of the things I've talked to all of you young ladies about is the importance of altruism. Now, who knows what altruism means? Unselfish concern to promote group interest. Now, listen, and the reason I tell you that altruism is so important is because, you know, you have to be an individual with a giving spirit, and you have to be an individual that's not afraid to actually sacrifice and do for others. And the most important thing also is when you talk about umoja and unity, because what we have here is a bunch of different generations of girls from a basketball team from all the same basketball program. And that's not normal for everybody around the state, around the country. Everybody don't do this. But, you know, I'm so proud of all of you young ladies. Some of you all are great mothers. Some of you all are doing fantastic in your career. Some of you all are excellent students, and some of you all are fantastic leaders. So I would just hope that in all of your time that you spent here at Afro Century, that you learned a lot more other than just playing basketball. And
me and Coach McKinney's relationship is, it's pretty interesting. Like, that's my dog. Like, I just know that he'll go to war for me. You know, I'll do anything for him. You know, and I know he can do anything for me, you know. That's like my family I call him my second dad. He always looks out for me, checks up on me, you know. He does the little stuff that other coaches don't do. And that's something it's hard to find nowadays because he's so dedicated and putting his time, his money. You know, he has a family and he's still pushing for us, and I just really respect that man.
It's extremely hard to win one state championship. There are a lot of great athletes who's never won at least one championship. So how difficult it is to win one state championship is extremely difficult. It's the highest level that you can go to in high school as far as sports. I mean, there's nothing higher than a state championship when it comes to high school sports. So to actually win one is extremely difficult, it's extremely hard. And also, people don't take into account just how unique that is. There are over 200 some odd high schools in just the state of Ohio. And there's only four state championships in each division, far as 1, 2, 3, and 4. So to be only one of four out of 200 plus schools is something special. And that's just in the state of Ohio. So to win just one state championship is something that you talk about to your grandkids.
Yeah, my teammates, man, we go through stuff, but at the end of the day, them are still my sisters, you feel me? Like we all hungry, we all wanna do the same thing, we all wanna win. And we always be clowning, so it just makes things a lot easier to get through, you know? When we have bad practices, we can come in here and just let it go. Because after that, we just all count on each other and just be cool.
Media day, we come together, we take pictures, listen to some music. We just enjoy each other.
Media day!
Yeah.
Thank you so much, y'all.
I saw the laugh.
I love it.
Oh man.
Nope.
Okay.
You should have laid like this.
Yeah.
No longer.
Hi, there
we go. Yeah, there we go.
What's the pose? Where was the pose?
It's Billy. Smile.
Whatever.
For your setup.
Okay. For your setup.
Following the highly publicized shoot with Sports Illustrated, it's back to the grind for Jordan and the Lady Nubians. The first taste of what's to come of the 2019 season is against defending champs Toledo Rogers, led by USA gold medalist high school phenom and longtime friend of Jordan, Zaya Cook.
Me and Zaya have been close for like, I remember the very first time we played her, it was in middle school. I think I was in seventh grade. And I remember she was like the only good girl on her team, and she was just like eating, like she was just like carrying her whole team.
I vividly remember Zaya Cook and Jordan playing against each other in middle school.
We're here representing the U.S. What?
Hey, what's up? I'm Zaya.
And I'm Jordan. We're here at the USA Challenge representing Ohio.
All right, so we've been knowing each other since like the sixth grade. I came to a tournament at her school, and she was shorter than me. But like, I was taller than her, and then she just bounced up on me out of nowhere. But we were going at it like the whole time. She was the first person to ever cross me in my life. So yeah, I had a lot of respect for her since then.
On the court, you know, I don't really have any friends on the court. That's my girl off the court, and we dap up right after the game, you know. But on the court, it's business, so that's how I treat it.
Coach Lamar, I remember him when he was a middle school coach. And so for him to have a state championship under his belt in Division II was great. And once again, they were the Division II champions.
That's yours.
Go to exactly.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Xavier,
put the balls on the ball rack. Right.
Let's have energy.
Some of the biggest challenges is just being able to galvanize so many different behaviors and so many different characteristics, and getting all of those different characters and behaviors and attitudes to come together in jail for one common goal. That's really the key to winning any championship, is to get different individuals to buy into one common goal.
What end we're going to be playing defense at?
We're going to be playing defense on this end.
This end?
Yeah. Okay. Yep. Okay. Come on out there. Leah, Sakima, Niam, Lexi, and Jordan.
They never got me one, two, three.
Hold on.
every superhero has his arch nemesis, Jordan would be no different. You see, Pinkerton High School has owned this rivalry. They have dominated this rivalry.
Because we never beat Pinkerton. Every time we play them, we always lose or, like, you know, come up like short. It always is a good game, but we never, like, seem to, like, pull it out.
Oh, yeah, this was a big game. I say this was the game of the year. This was the biggest game on the schedule to the Nubians. This meant more than basketball to Jordan. This meant pride for the Nubians.
Our game versus Pinkerton Central this year was an extremely big game. One, because Pinkerton Central was the Division One defending state champion. So they had just won a state championship in Division One.
And the plot even thickens, you see. Pinkerton star point guard Malia Perry is a fearless competitor. And this just happened to be Jordan's best friend.
Several of the girls at Pinkerton Central played AAU with some of the girls at Afrocentric. Jordan Horston and Malia Perry being really good friends.
Me and Jordan been best friends since, I want to say, like, eighth grade. But we met each other, I think it was like we were in seventh grade. It was like this OGBR thing at the battle border. And she was on my team, and all I could really, like, my first impression was she's just, like, she's dope.
Don't think for one second that this friendship was going to stop Malia Perry from not wanting to beat Afrocentric and Jordan, despite their friendship.
Me and Jordan's relationship, of course, off the court is always going to be tight. But, I mean, on the court, you can't have any friends on the court. So, you know, when it's basketball, it's basketball. And, you know, we know at the end of the day, that's how the game is. So after the game, you know, we can dap it up, you know, be best friends again. But on the court, you know, we just got to, you know, basically be enemies.
This is Must See TV. Can Jordan Horston and the Lady Nubians protect their perfect season?
Lady Nubians on three. One, two, three.
Lady Nubians.
Game, but we never, like, seemed to, like, pull it out. And so this year we was, like, really, really, we really wanted to win. We really wanted to go undefeated.
We was going to either pull it together or we was going to lose, period, because they was coming at us like every team is going to come at us because every team, we're the team right now to beat. And if we get beat, then they the team.
Was history repeating itself? Was this game slipping away from Coach McKinney and the Lady Nubians again?
When a game is tight, the tension is high, and you at that fork in the road where something great has to happen, my message to the team is one, just be calm and be confident.
Other than that, man, I mean, they made a run at us. We kind of held on, but hey, you know, it's a new quarter now. And what this second half is going to boil down to is whoever comes out with the most energy. That's what it's gonna boil down to whoever comes out with the most energy. The fact that y'all are playing and y'all supporting each other. You know what I'm saying? That's to be commended.
All three, y'all. Lady Nubians on three. One, two, three.
Lady Nubians.
Horston fires from deep. Boom! That's
rebounds, y'all in that eight. Jordan had not scored until
we were go 50 red right first
we lost
okay.
containment. You guys got to keep her in front of you.
This is Must See TV. Can Jordan Horstin and the Lady Nubians protect their perfect season against Ohio State commit J.C. Shelton and the women of Dublin Kaufman?
Our expectations for this year is to go undefeated, go back-to-back for the first time because that's never been done.
Tell me all this. If you keep walking around on defense, you're gonna lose this game. You have to pick up your intensity, stop just walking, and if you don't sprint back, the game's gonna be over.
Horstin from behind. What a block! Whoa! She looked like Superwoman without the cape.
Oh, say does the star-spangled banner wave o'er the land of the free and the
Horstin from behind. What a block! Whoa! She looked like Superwoman without the cape. Wow, what a pass from Horstin. She must have eyes in the back of her head.
Tonight on Streets Illustrated Sports, Jordan Horstin and the Lady Nubians sweeping through the season and pouncing on Northland High, clinching their fourth consecutive city championship with their eyes on the prize, back-to-back state championship, and a perfect season.
So after the semifinal game, I talked with Jordan in the hallway and she said, Mama, I think I'm getting sick. And I was like, okay. And then she was limping on her ankle too. So now she's feeling sick and she's limping. Later on that evening, I checked in on her and she said that she had to go to urgent care and that she has the flu.
So Malika called me and said, I don't think that Jordan's gonna be able to play.
Jordan would face one of her biggest challenges in the 2019 Ohio Girls State Championship game.
I took Jordan to the urgent care in Bexley because it was closest to the school. And as soon as we walked in the door, she started throwing up. I was like, oh yeah, she's sick, sick. When we got back to the office, the doctor just looked at her and was like, you have the flu. And he said, I'm just looking at you and I can just tell and all your symptoms are and it's going around really bad. Everybody is catching the flu.
With a perfect season on the line and a chance to win consecutive
state championships. Waynesville High was not the only obstacle for Jordan to overcome. Just like her namesake, Michael Jordan, she caught the flu before the biggest game of her life and played against doctor's orders.
Now, the big story here tonight concerning Michael Jordan's physical conditions. He is suffering from flu-like symptoms. His status is uncertain.
I found out about Jordan having the flu the day before the state championship game. You know, we had a shootout, and she still came to the shootout. But after that, you know, she was really, really down, and she wasn't feeling well at all. You know, but it was like, oh man, hopefully she'll be okay for the game tomorrow. But you know, you can just tell she wasn't herself. And then like that whole week, it was kind of like somewhat of a bug going around, because it was a few different people that was sick. It's just unfortunate that she had kind of got sick at the last minute.
Took her temperature. Our temperature was 102. 102.7, by the way. And so she looked at him and she said, "So what you gonna give me? Because I got a game tomorrow." And he looked at her and he was like, "I don't think your body is gonna let you play." She said, "No, I'm playing. Do you have some medicine that you can give me? Because I'm playing tomorrow."
I mean, there's never no doubt in my mind that she was gonna play. Yeah, I just told her, "You know, this is your last high school game ever. You're never gonna be a high school senior again. Never gonna play for another state championship game. Even if you just play a few minutes, I mean, she's gonna find a way." So there's never no real concern about me thinking that she wasn't gonna play.
Did I think she was gonna play? Yeah, I knew she was gonna play, you know. And at the same time, I wanted her to play because I know this was something that it was her senior year. It was something that I know she wanted to be a part of. And so, you know, I wanted her to have opportunity to do that her last year. You know, it was her senior year, and she really, really wanted to play bad. You know, she didn't want to miss that game at all.
I found out the same day they found out, and my mom, like, is always making Jordan food, like, all the time. She has a day, she has a schedule, a regimen. She goes to the store, like, she balls out. So she was like, "Oh, I'm making Jordan soup." I'm like, "Okay, whatever." And she was like, "Oh, she has the flu." So I'm like, "Oh, well, is she playing?"
Jordan texts me and said, "Can you please make me some soup? Because I make this soup that the family likes." And I said, "Sure thing." So I take it, I make the soup, and I go to the hotel where she's at, resting, getting ready for the big game. And she's laying in the bed, and it was about 6 o'clock. Gave her a cup of the broth, left. Her mom said she would sleep by 7 o'clock.
She was like, "Go on, give me the medicine." She took the medicine.
We get in the car and we're driving all the way to the hotel. And I go up there, I'm nervous, like, what if she's like leaning and over, like. So we go inside of the room and she was just laying there, you know, cooling out, you know, got this cool mask, like, you know, "I'm cool, like, I'm going to do this game, it's gonna be all good," you know what I'm saying? But I knew, like, she was sick and she needed to break, but Jordan doesn't tap out at all. She don't tap out, no matter what the circumstances are.
Being ranked so high, it's a lot of pressure that comes with it. Just knowing I don't want to let anyone down, my teammates down, my family down. I just want to make everybody proud. So it's a lot of pressure, but the way I get through that is I just, you know, keep my faith in God. I pray.
I didn't really expect her to play. I expected her to sit on the bench. I knew it was going to be a tough game because it was one of the rival teams that they always play, and it was going to be rough. So I called McKinney in the morning, like, you know, how she's doing when they were supposed to be going to shoot around. He was like, "Man, she seemed like she's feeling better. So we're going to see. She's at least shooting the ball now." I said, "Okay." And I said, well, we'll see, you know. So I didn't expect to see her playing, really, when I came.
Reporting live from the 2019 Ohio Girls Basketball State Championship, we just got the word that Jordan Horston will be playing with the flute despite doctor's orders. Can the Lady Nubians win consecutive state championships with their star guard under the weather?
So I didn't expect to see her playing, really, when I came, because I knew the doctor said her body was going to give up on her. So... but she went out there and missed a whole lot of shots. However, she did a whole lot of stuff that I could never do.
Horston shoots. She misses.
The Lady Nubians faced adversity for the first time in their magical season and were outmatched, missing their first 22 shots.
It's been a tough half shooting for the Nubians. Horston fires. She misses again. They can't buy a bucket as the half comes to an end. You know, you have to wonder, has the flu got the best of Horston? It's obviously affecting her play.
I don't think Jordan's illness had anything to do with how bad we shot the basketball. I just think we just shot it bad. But for some strange reason, as bad as we were shooting the basketball, I never really was concerned about the game. You know, I never really was in a panic.
Games is close. What's usually going through my head is just stay calm, you know. Just stay calm. Don't let the little things get to us. You know, try to keep my teammates calm. Just stay aggressive. Don't get too comfortable, you know. Know that every good team is going to make runs, but we got to keep playing through everything, anything that's thrown our way.
House is packed and pumped. Horston from behind, what a block, whoa! Horston on a break, she has numbers! What a pass! Wow, what a pass from Horston. Walker with the steal, she shoots! Bang, what a shot, wow! The Nubians come out a different team in the second half. Nubians press, turnover Nubian ball. Horston fires from deep, boom! That should do it, folks. Horston and the Nubians win their school's 7th state championship under Coach William McKinney. You have to tip your hat off to this guy, what a career. Horston displaying why she's the country's top prospect with an absolutely fantastic game to seal an outstanding high school career.
The pressure that's coming with it, I know that I can get through it because I know God wouldn't put me in a situation that I'm not able to push through. So I just look at it like that. I just try to look at the positive. When there's something negative, just try to push through, you know, just pray, you know, just stay in God's ear.
With the season going as well as Jordan expected, Jordan received news that she was named a McDonald's All-American. This honor is only allocated to the nation's top basketball players.
A long time ago, a young lady started playing basketball around the age of 4 or 5. Mothers as one of your own, and what she is today is a McDonald's All-American.
We are so pleased to be announcing the official rosters for the 2019 Boys and Girls High School All-America Games. Jordan Horston, number 2 ranked player, according to ESPNW. She's headed to Tennessee in the fall.
Okay.
Jordan has a great court awareness, like defense awareness and office awareness, as far as like knowing where she is on the court.
I mean, Jordan Horston just taking over this quarter by herself.
You can't teach those things.
Let them know.
She got some swag.
I think a great part about McDonald's All-American games is you get to see the elite guys, but you also get to see the elite female.
Mm-hmm.
Having that platform for female basketball players makes us a fan early in their career.
She's really good.
I can't wait to see Jordan at the McDonald's All-American games. She may be my front runner for MVP.
Yes, that's who does that. My granddaughter, God, grace and mercy.
Hmm. She's about to have some church up in here.
Look,
look at
I'm about
look
to
at
cry.
Look at her.
You
see it?
I'm trying to tell you.
Yeah. Talk about it.
You know what I mean?
Talk about it.
You never know what the goodness of God will bring in one's life. When me being a mother, an unwed mother, wanting to have a child, after I found out I was pregnant, not before. And this is what it evolved to. Having a son who marries a beautiful wife, who have two beautiful children, and they both are intelligent, articulate, mindful, respectful, honorable, beautiful. Did I say beautiful? Loving, and know God. To see how God has blessed and graced our family with such a time as this, to see the baby girl excel to this magnitude of life, I couldn't have never dreamed it. I could have never imagined such a wondrous work of God on my family, on my life, and with this baby. Oh my God, and there she is. How beautiful is this? How beautiful are you? Thank you, God.
We welcome you to the 2019 McDonald's All-American Girls Game here inside State Farm Arena in Atlanta.
Apple Central is a little small school in Columbus, Ohio. We won the state 7 times, and this girl is playing big time in McDonald's All-American Game.
Taken over this quarter by herself.
Horston, the quick cross and take.
Nice job. Well, Jordan Horston at 6'2", headed to Tennessee, has taken over this quarter. Scouting report on her is she does everything well.
Are pleased to provide with 14 points, 4 rebounds, and 1 assist. Let's give a big round of applause to this evening's most valuable player from the East team, number 23, Jordan Horston.
You know, it's all just surreal right now. You know, it's just everything is just happening so fast. And like I said, it's God. Honestly, I just know it's God. But at this point in my life, I can't see how big it is right now. But I know that I have to stay humble and just stay aggressive, stay hungry, and stay in the gym. Because, you know, like, God gave it to me, but it can be taken away at any time. So I'm just blessed.
Like that. She loves guards that know how to pick it up in game time. And man, talk about a talent here. Jordan Horston. Mike, she's going to Tennessee. Holly Borlick out as the head coach of Tennessee. Jordan Horston. What are we going to do about Tennessee? Will she stay going there? A big storyline to follow.
Holly and Coach Reeves mainly recruited Jordan. For the last couple of years. They had a great relationship, you know, and I can just see the difference when she spoke to them on the phone when they was recruiting her, when we went on campus, just the whole feel, the whole situation was always good. And Jordan is a relationship type of person. She makes decisions based on how she feels about people more than anything else. However, she did love the campus, Tennessee. Everything that Tennessee had to offer was top notch, and she loved it. She loved it from the fan base where, I mean, we went on a, I think it was like maybe a Wednesday or a Thursday before she committed, And when I say the stands was packed to see them girls play, it was packed. And so, you know, that was, she loved that. She loved, so when they came in and we went on our official visit, that was it. Everything had to feel the way that she felt about Tennessee. And she knew, like, these are girls that I want to play with. These are the girls that I feel like I want to grow with, and that's going to be there, you know, for most of the time that I'm going to be here. That's what she said. So she selected them. And so when Holly and her staff was let go, she just didn't know what to do.
Has her ball intercepted, driving in, Horston scores with a left hand. Hello from Horston.
Horston's really sparked them. She's long, she's athletic, she's talented.
The offensive rebound and putback, Horston.
There has to be a lot of talk about her being a potential MVP of this tournament.
Lord, I ask that you guide me through this decision. Close all the doors that I'm not supposed to go through. I ask that you just give me the strength.
Horston scores with a left hand.
Horston's come out. She's ready to play today.
Horston's out, and you know who. The offensive rebound and putback, Horston.
There has to be a lot of talk about her being a potential MVP of this tournament.
I ask that you just give me the strength to keep fighting, to choose the right school. Close all the doors that I'm not supposed to go through.
Jordan would remain loyal to the University of Tennessee despite the firing of Coach Warlock.
Where do I see Jordan's career on the next level? Next year, I think she's going to be stepping into a really good situation. You know, she's going to University of Tennessee. They're starting off with a brand new coach. The coach going to, like, put the ball in her hands and let her be the lead guard. And that's something I think that she's, what position she plays the best at. And she's going to be surrounded by a whole lot of talented girls. They have a whole lot of size. They have shooters. They just have a whole lot of things. So she's going to be in a real good situation. And her being in such a good situation and being around big players who can score and her dishing the ball and delivering the ball to those players, that's just on the, I see her being like freshman of the year SEC, you know. I see them probably going to the Final Four next year. I think they had the girls to do it. I mean, you have six or seven McDonald's All-Americans on that bench, so those girls, I think they're on a really confident.
Being the MVP of the McDonald's game, and Jordan even just being a McDonald's All-American, as far as her legacy, it cements her as one of the elite girl basketball players ever in the state of Ohio, and definitely one of the best girls basketball players ever in the city of Columbus. And as far as Afrocentric goes, it just kind of adds on and puts us finally in that conversation of a school that just was able to have an extraordinary player and a McDonald's All-American to be part of the tradition here. And you know, she just kind of set the bar for whoever wants to come here and do something else great and magnificent. Now that's just, she just raised that bar extraordinarily high.
Very proud of both of my granddaughters, and I know that Jordan's gonna make it, and whatever she does, and both of them, Jasmine too. But just to treat people right, the way that you want to be treated, you know, don't ever look down on nobody. Don't ever look down on nobody. The people that you see on the way up, you'll see them coming back down. So treat them right.
I feel like Jordan is my child. Even though she's my sister, we're not that far apart. But I don't know. I feel really proud. Like, I brag about Jordan a lot to like a lot of people. I'm happy for her, like genuinely. Like I'm probably Jordan's biggest fan. And no matter what happens, like even though sometimes she drives me absolutely freaking insane, I probably would do, like I would do anything for her. So like whatever she chooses to do, I'm always gonna be proud of her.
My sister, she's crazy, but it's like a good crazy. You know, I know she'll go to war for me any day. And I just love her. She's like, not my first friend.
I don't have no apologies for it, and to go wherever she goes, she's gonna be great. I already know that because that's just how she is. She's always been the underdog. She's always excelled, and she does it, you know, just because of her work ethic and because of her faith in God and because of her humbleness. So I'm not too worried about it, and the advice is just, you know, to choose yourself.